last Sunday, I introduced a new series, and we're talking about the three habits that we see in Jesus' life that helped him through his own personal hard times and the hard times in which he lived. And we talked about how he made it a habit on a regular basis to go to synagogue and gather with God's people together. And we saw how he made a habit of having a quiet time with God. And we saw and talked about how those quiet times with God benefited his life in so many different ways. And then we saw that he made a habit of using his gifts to serve others. Next week, I want to talk to you very specifically about how to have a quiet time with God, how to really organize that, how to really get it going in your life and make it a habit and the benefits for you in your own life. But today I want to talk about how making worship a regular habit in our lives can help us experience God in our lives. Worship is how we respond to God. It's just how we respond to God. So worship involves the whole of life. Everything in your daily life can be worship. Great verse about it in the Bible is Colossians chapter 3, verse 17. Whatever you do in word, speech, or deed, action, behaviors, do everything in the name of our Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Doing everything in the name of the Lord, your whole life is worship. Whether you're at work and you're working, whether you're talking on the phone, whether you're doing the dishes, you know, it doesn't matter what you're doing. You can do it in the name of the Lord. There's a way to do it, and that is worship. But today I want to take that word worship, and I want to bring it down in that narrower sense that we use it of our Sunday assembly. We're going to worship God. And making something a habit means you have to believe that the effort required will make a valuable difference in your life. You're not going to establish any new habit in your life if you don't first believe that the effort you make is going to have a payoff, that's going to make a difference in your life. If you believe that spending money is more satisfying than saving money, you're going to have a hard time saving any money. But if you believe that if you save more money, the payoff is going to be greater than spending it in the immediate, then you're going to be able to establish a new habit in your life. If you believe that eating sweets is more satisfying than eating vegetables, you're going to have a hard time making a habit of eating more healthy. And when it comes to making worship a regular habit in our lives, the same thing applies. If we don't first believe that the effort is going to have a great payoff in our lives, we're not going to do it. If it isn't meeting a significant need, we're going to have a hard time making a regular habit. Now, let me say right up front in the message this morning that all of us experience times in our lives when we can't make it to church. We can't get to worship. We might be on vacation. We might have health reasons that keep us from coming. We might have a job requirement that keeps us away. We might have conflicts in the home that at some points are just too much and we can't make it. And of course, right now, the pandemic is keeping a great many people home where they feel safe. And the last thing that I want to do today is lay some kind of a guilt trip on people about that. That's not what this message is about. I think we all come to church with an expectation. And we come to church with an expectation that today we're going to experience God in some way. We need encouragement, and we come expecting to be encouraged. We need inspiration, and we come expecting to be inspired. We need instruction on how to live our lives, and we come with our problem, with our need, and we present it to God with the hope that we will hear an answer from God. We need to know when we come that we're not alone in our struggles. We're not alone with our problems. We're not alone with our fears. So we come. We need to know that God loves us. We need to be reminded of his love, like we sang about this morning. We need to be reminded that there are certain things in life that are more important than others. And there are certain people in life that are more important to us than any other. We need to know that we have a future and that our future is secure. That we have hope. And we come to church because this is the place where God invited us to meet with him. That might be the biggest reason of all. We've been invited and we come. But there's a big question. And the big question is, then why aren't more of us experiencing God in worship like we should and like we want to? Why aren't we really experiencing God to the maximum? That can be the biggest hang-up of making it a regular habit. And if that's the biggest hang-up, we're not really experiencing God the way I'd hoped to, how are we going to make it a habit? How are we going to get past that? There are six reasons why we are not experiencing God more in worship. And they may speak to you in a particular way today. One of them might. All six of them might. I don't know. But I want to share all six with you this morning of why it becomes difficult to make regular worship a habit in our lives. What are the things that are blocking us? What's preventing us? Number one, it's boring. Listen, if Sunday worship is boring, then something is missing in your life. Someone has come along and pulled the plug and the power is gone. Something got disconnected. When you are bored, your mind is somewhere else. And wherever your mind is, your body is going to soon follow. And if your mind is somewhere else other than worshiping God, your body's going to get to that same place. When we get bored with church, it's usually because we come with a kind of a wrong or misplaced expectation, a wrong understanding of what's really going on. If we come to experience God, we first of all have to remember that an experience is always the result of something else. An experience is always the result of something else. You can't have an experience without there being something to experience. It doesn't happen. If you say, that is delicious chocolate ice cream, then what have you experienced? Ice cream, particularly chocolate. If you are experiencing a beautiful sunset, it's because there's a sun to experience. There's a sky to do all the reflections and refractions. And if you come to church to experience God, you won't have an experience unless there is a God. It is hard to live in a world that encourages you every day to live by your feelings. You're bombarded with messages that it's all about you, and you should be choosing what's right for you, and you should be going the direction that's best for you. And you are the one who makes all those decisions. It's all about you. You deserve it. And if you live in a world that is telling you that you should do everything according to your feelings And then you come into a church and you sit down in the services that puts the emphasis not on your feelings, but on who you feel. That's a different thing. You just walked into a different world. The emphasis is not on you. It's on who you feel. You can't have the experience without the reality of God. We don't live by our feelings, but by the God we feel. Now, look at church services the same way that you would look at yourself or other people. In other words, give yourself a little room to grow. Give yourself a little permission to be yourself. Give other people permission to be who they are. And give church the permission to be as it is. You don't judge and condemn yourself because you fail. We do from time to time, but we're not supposed to. We're supposed to, if God is gracious with us, we need to be gracious with ourselves. If God is gracious with other people, we need to be gracious to other people. And when we come into church, we need a little grace. You don't judge people where they are. You judge people by where they can be. The way Peter, or Jesus came to Peter and said, Simon, I'm going to call you Rock, Peter. He was judging, evaluating, he was seeing Peter according to what he was going to be, not what he was that day. And we should do the same thing with ourselves. We should do the same thing with other people. And we should do the same thing when we walk into a church. Not exactly what I see in the moment, but what could this be? How does God see it? You're here this morning, my guess. You're here this morning because you want to improve your life. You're here because you want more out of life. You got up and you got ready and you made the effort because there's something that you expect. You don't want to condemn yourself to mediocrity. People who get up and do something like you just did today don't want to be condemned to the status quo. Don't want to be condemned to mediocrity. You want something more. And you came so you can improve yourself. More than that, but that's part of it. And if you're tempted to think that a church service is too boring, just remember, you always get out of something what you put into it, right? Try to remember that it will never always be the way it is. That God is building his church, Jesus is building his church, and it's going to be better. Sometimes we miss a couple of key things about Jesus building his church, like in Ephesians, where it says it's always under construction. What would it be like to live in a house that is always under construction, never finished? A little dusty, a little confusing, a little chaotic. And that's the church. Always under construction. The second reason why sometimes we don't experience God in church like we want to and we should is number two, it's not relevant to my life. I think it's one of the key reasons a lot of people stay away from church. You want to know what my greatest fear in preaching is? My greatest fear. It's answering questions no one is asking. That's my greatest fear. My second greatest fear is being boring. That would be bad too. But my first fear is answering questions no one's asking. And if you look at Jesus' ministry through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you just observe what he's doing in his ministry, you will quickly see, I think, how he begins with people's needs first. He begins with what's pressing upon their lives, what their problems are, what their fears are, what their needs are, and then he teaches them. People are hungry, he feeds them. and he teaches them. If people are blind, he heals them. If they're lame, he heals them. If they're sick, he heals them. And then he teaches them. He teaches them. He is always first addressing people's actual needs, where they're at. And he meets people where they're at. And then he leads them and teaches them about the kingdom of God. So what are people's immediate needs today? There's a lot we could say here, but I want to just try to bring it to a place where we say, what's the big one? What's the big one that we all face? And I think it's a crisis of truth in our society, an absolute crisis of truth. The difference between a crisis and a problem you have to seek the solution and you can find it. There's a solution to a problem. A crisis is a problem that does not seem to have any solution. No one knows what to do. That's the difference of a crisis. And we are facing a crisis of truth in our society, in our world. I read an author, I'm reading this book, printed, I think, at first about 1890, maybe the early, right at the turn of the century, 19th century. 20th century, I mean. And the author in this book warned us then, more than 100 years ago, he said, if we repudiate the reality of God, we destroy the idea of truth. If we repudiate the reality of God, we destroy the idea of truth. Now here we are, more than 120 years later, and everything is being redefined. And no one knows which way to turn. And no one knows what's going to come next. And people today have questions about their identity. And gender issues. Right to life issues. Right to death issues. Immigration issues. Where to live in the world. Where to live in society. To live in the city or live in the country. How do you raise kids in today's world? How do they do it? What's right for public education? And the list just goes on and on and on. But it all comes back to the issue of truth and the crisis of truth that we're facing. So if somebody is experiencing this crisis of truth and they have all these questions and they come to church, what should they expect? I think there's a verse in the Bible that is awesome. And I love the Jerusalem Bible translation of it, Colossians 4, verses 5 and 6, where Paul says, be tactful with those who are not Christians. Be tactful. Tact is a very precious thing. Be tactful with those who are not Christians. And be sure that you make the best use of your time with them. Don't waste their time. Time is a valuable commodity. Treat their time with dignity. Talk to them agreeably. That's great. Don't get into fights with them. Don't argue with them. No point in that. Talk to them agreeably. And with a flavor of wit, a little humor, a little charm, a little interest, a little salt, a little flavor. And try, doesn't say you're going to always succeed, but try to fit your answers to the needs of each one, their needs. Then how important would it be then to listen to other people and listen to what they need, what they say, what they're facing, what they're going through, and then try to fit your answer to their needs. I sometimes wonder why a church could not use that verse as a strategy for developing worship on a Sunday morning. What an awesome verse to develop a strategy of worship for a church. And if they have needs and you're giving answers, They have questions. What are their questions? The truth is, we all live in the same world, Christian and non-Christian together. And we all are facing the same issues, and we have the same kinds of questions, and we're going through the same kinds of problems as other people are. We just need to make sure that we're addressing the questions, talking about the needs. Churches were never meant to be monasteries where you can escape from the world. Churches, the Bible calls them, outposts of the kingdom of God. They're in the world for the sake of the world, not for their own sake. Being relevant means we should always be thinking and wondering and praying, how can we address this message to their address? We should always be doing that. Third reason that sometimes people come to church and don't experience God as they should. And number three is unconfessed sin. Unconfessed sin. And I suppose if we were to rank these six reasons, this might be number one. It's a big one. Look at Isaiah 59, verse 2 on the screens. God says, but your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. If we are not experiencing God, and God wants us to know him, and God wants to be in a loving relationship with us, God wants us to be in his family, and God is holy and perfect, then the problem of separation is not with God. He's perfect. Problem's on our side. And it's our sin that separates us from God. Sin interferes with our relationship with God. And let's be clear what sin is and what it isn't. I'm battling a fly up here. Can you see the fly? If you one of those concealed carry people, you're welcome to take it out and shoot that fly. Just not while he's on my ear, you know. I didn't actually say that. Please don't do that, all right? Let's be clear about what sin is and what isn't. Sin isn't I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't go out with girls that do. It's not all those ugly, bad behaviors and talk. Those might be the result of sin in somebody's life, but that's not sin. Sin in the Bible means to miss the mark, miss the target. Sin is an archery word. You put the target up, you take your bow and arrow, and you shoot it, and you completely miss the target. Done that a lot of times in my life in archery. And that's what sin is. And God says, here is what a human being is to be like. He created Adam with an idea in mind. And Jesus fulfills it perfectly. Jesus is the target to be like Christ. And when we miss the target, we sin. That's what sin is. Falling short, being off track, being off target. Not conforming to God's image in us. Bible uses different words to describe it. Sometimes the Bible uses the word rebellion, where you know this is what God's word teaches, but you are so concerned that you want to experience it, you want to get it, whatever it is, and you just sort of say to God, to his face, no. I'm going to try this. I want to know what it's like. I'm going to do this. That's rebellion. Sometimes it uses the word transgression, which is a line in the sand. And God says, don't cross that line. If you cross that line, you're going to get hurt. Something awful is going to happen to you. Don't cross that line. And what do? We step across the line. We touch the wet paint. Sometimes it uses the word iniquity to talk about our sin. Iniquity means something that's twisted or distorted. There's something wrong because it all got twisted up and distorted. You sort of see a little bit of the truth, but you don't see the whole truth. Things get distorted. That's iniquity. Now, no one has ever done anything that was a surprise to God. No one has done anything that God can't forgive, that he can't fix. There's only one unpardonable sin, the Bible says. And if you ever are concerned that you've done it, you haven't, because you're concerned. The problem is, we have sins in our lives from time to time, maybe one lingering in your life, that have never been confessed. And it keeps us from really experiencing God. To confess, all it means, the word confess, to confess is means you agree with God about it. You're in agreement. That's all. God says, you did wrong when you said that. You did wrong when you did that. You did wrong when you went there. And you come along and say, I admit it, God, I did wrong. Said that, I shouldn't have gone there. I shouldn't have done that. I did wrong. You're in agreement with God. But there are times in our lives where that rebellious spirit, where that spirit of transgression, or that distorted part of us, that iniquity, that we get into a struggle with God about it. And we make up excuses, and it's not that bad, and it's something I really need in my life. You don't really understand me, God. And we come up with all these things in our lives of why we can't just say, you're right, I agree with you. When we are young, we learn to hide our problems. We learn to hide our hurts. And then we get into this messy, confusing part of life where we're not experiencing full love because we're hiding. And we learn to hide our hurts, and we learn to hide our wrongs, because the world is so unconditional, so conditional with love. Love is so conditioned. When we're young and in school and with our parents, we learn, boy, if I don't get that grade, I don't feel that accepted. If I don't perform well in the game, I'm not up to par. I'm not like other people, and we compare, and we get this conditional thing going on in our lives. Everybody goes through it. And then we're afraid. And being afraid, we start to hide. And we repress our feelings. We repress our guilt. We put it down. Somebody comes along and says, no need to feel guilty about that. Okay, I won't be. Only we're missing out on experiencing real love and God. We become so determined to protect ourselves that it makes it hard to experience the unconditional love of God that is being offered to us. How could he love me unconditionally because there's so many things wrong with me? We have such a hard time accepting grace. And that means that we come as broken people to church. And we come with some kind of a hidden wrong in our hearts, and we're afraid to face it and confess it. And the result is we miss out on the full experience of God. Now, I don't mean that, you know, you come to church and you stand up before everybody and said, okay, here's my hidden sin for years and years and years, you know, and everybody hears it. No, that's not what the Bible says. Everybody doesn't need to hear it. God needs to hear it. And the Bible says, confess your sins to one another. One another isn't everybody. One another means there's somebody in your life that you could unload this on, that you could be free of the burden. Listen, I've been there in life. I had a friend that I could just share something that troubled me from high school and beyond, and earlier than that. And I just let it out, and I just cried like a baby afterwards. But for so many years, pastor can't have this problem. Pastor can't confess this sin and be a good pastor. I was hiding. Number four, another thing that keeps us from experiencing God, unresolved relationships. Look what Jesus says in Matthew 5 from the Message Bible. If you enter your place of worship and about to make an offering, you suddenly remember a grudge a friend has against you. Abandon your offering, leave immediately, go to this friend and make things right. Then and only then come back and work things out with God. Probably not a good time to get up and go to the bathroom right now. People might wonder. Jesus is emphasizing how serious an unresolved relationship can be. And he says, it can prevent you from really experiencing God. Get up and, first of all, go fix that relationship and then come back and worship God. And as a preacher, I love the fact that he says, leave your offering. That's great. Just leave it on the pew. We'll get it. That's a joke, folks. Didn't come off very good. How can we have a healthy relationship with God if we have an unhealthy relationship with one of his kids? Look at Colossians 3:13. Bear with each other. Put up with each other. And forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. What does healthy look like? Healthy is defined by God. God took the initiative and he came to us while we were still sinners, still lost in our wrongs. He came to seek us out before we were seeking him out. That's the pattern. And Jesus says, if anyone has a grudge against you, you get up and go to them first. You initiate it. You start the process. If they've got a grudge against you, and if you are the one grudged, if that's a word, if you are the one who has been wronged, you forgive them. You take the initiative. You don't wait for them to come and make it right. You don't wait for them to follow Jesus' instructions. You just forgive them. How many times have I heard somebody say, I'll forgive them as soon as they say they're sorry? That's not the point. That's the world's way. God's way is to say, I've already forgiven them. I've already released it. I'm not going to hurt back. I'm not holding it anymore. So when that person comes and says, you know, if you're still angry about what I said, I want to repair it, that person can say, it's already done. Let's hug, move on. But an unresolved relationship can really destroy how you experience God. Number five, the fifth one is our problem with D's, not B's. B's are baldness and bifocals and bulges and bunions and stuff like that. This is the problem with D's. And it can, worship and our experience of God can be severely damaged by words that begin with D in English. Distractions. Depression. Spiritual dryness. Discouragement. Difficulties, doubts, dangers. And you can get the dictionary out. You can probably make another long list and add to it. Throughout this pandemic, I have watched us all become distracted. And I would say that's about the biggest problem I've seen during the pandemic. Biggest problem, distraction. Being distracted by political issues, being distracted by trust issues, being distracted by what scientists say or don't say, or who says what. that the devil has just won a great game and a great battle by distracting us. We are here to make disciples. We're here to bring people who are disconnected from God into a relationship with God. That's why we're here. And we'd be so easily distracted. People struggle with depression more now than ever before during this pandemic. The loneliness and the depression. We all go through periods of spiritual dryness. Like we're in a desert. We pray and no answer. We're thirsty, no water. We all go through periods of spiritual dryness. We just go through these times where everything just seems to go flat. We start something with a great idea, only to get discouraged by the lack of progress. Things aren't changing the way we hope they will change. We get discouraged. We face all kinds of new challenges now. And these new challenges put new difficulties in front of us that we've never faced before. We battle periods of doubts in our life. And we live in a world that's increasingly a dangerous place to live. All those things can impact how we experience God and worship. I don't believe that God wants us to go to church to escape all these things. I don't believe that he wants us to ignore them. He doesn't want us to bury them. I actually believe that he wants us to bring them to church. Not leave them in the parking lot, but bring them all the way into the building. Bring them all the way into the gathering of God's people. Why? Because if there is something from that list troubling your heart, then God's heart is troubled for you. And he wants to be with you in that trouble. And if you're discouraged, he wants you to come to him and talk about it. And if you're having doubts, he wants you to come to him and talk about it. And if you're having difficulties in your life that seem insurmountable, he wants you to come to church, talk to him about it, and be with God's people. Don't leave them at home. Don't try to ignore them. Bring them to church. Number six, the last one, my priorities get messed up. My priorities just get all messed up. And it keeps me from experiencing God. If I gave you a list of words and I asked you to prioritize them, put them in a priority list, but I said, I want you to prioritize them, not ideally, this is the ideal list, but I asked you to prioritize them as they are in your life today, really, really. You were just honest between you and God. So I started giving you words. You prioritize them. God, Jesus, church, spouse, work, school, children, possessions, money, ministry, house, freedom, relaxation, vacation, personal interest, quality time, fun, friends, extended family. If any of those words, what's the real list? Not the ideal list. What's the real list? And if you made an ideal list and then you made the real list, how far apart are they? Are they identical? Or is there a gap? How much fluctuation between the two lists? You start off on Monday morning with ideal. How long does it take you to get to real? What causes the fluctuation? back during the pandemic in about last February, I just thought, got to make some changes. So I started an exercise program in the morning. Really hard to keep at it for about 30 minutes. But once, after about 8 weeks, 9 weeks passed, I started to look forward to it most of the days of the week. The same is true for my quiet time over the years. It took me a while to get to the place where I've got a quiet time figured out and how it works. Making changes once in a while, you know, schedule-wise and stuff. But it took a while for it to become a habit, so I'm looking at it and anticipating and excited about it every morning. Same was true for tithing in my life. A few years ago, when I was on my own, I just had to make a decision about that myself. I'm the only one who's going to make a decision about it. Am I going to tithe? And I decided to make it a priority in my life. And I decided that when we started doing texting here with giving, I went, this is great. This really fits me. Because as soon as that money is in the account in the bank, I want my worship to be a priority. I want my 10% to go to God immediately before I use that money for anything else. That's important to me. That other people may not be wired that way. That's important to me, to give that 10% before I do anything else with that money. And texting gives me that opportunity to do that. And when I exercise as a habit, and when I have my quiet time as a habit, and when I make sure every month I'm doing my tithe, I just feel better physically and spiritually. I have my ups and downs like anybody else, but my life just seems more trusting in God. Jesus says in Matthew 6:33, but first, be concerned about his kingdom and what has his approval. And then all these other things will be added to you. Everything else will fall into place. But first, the priority of seeking his kingdom. And the verse before it is interesting because it says, don't be concerned about missing out, but first be concerned about the kingdom. Brilliant translation. Don't be concerned about missing out. Isn't that what lies behind so much of our motivation in life? I might miss out. Isn't that what lies behind a lot of our rebellion and our transgressions? I might miss out. I don't want to miss out. Here's something I would really desire. Here's something I've always wanted. I might miss out. And the way to counter that is to say, don't be concerned about what you might miss. Be concerned about his kingdom first. And all that other stuff will be added. Matter of priorities. What we need to do is make a decision, or some decisions, about our priorities. To take the list, put them in priority, and stick with it until it becomes a healthy habit. They say it takes 6 weeks for something to become a new habit. My experience, for Gary, much longer. But when it does become a habit, then I look forward to it. But it takes time. And you have to make a decision that I'm going to stick with this for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 9 weeks, 10 weeks, whatever. I'm going to stick with it. That's only a decision you can make. No one can make it for you. You've heard me say this many times. I'm going to say it again this morning. If we are not intimate with the ultimate, we will succumb to the immediate. If we're not intimate with God, we're going to succumb to all the problems, all the difficulties, all the issues, all the stuff around us. And all six of these things I've mentioned this morning are intimacy destroyers. Intimacy destroyers. And I learned along the way of my life that you cannot have intimacy without proximity. They go together, obviously. But you can't have intimacy with anyone unless you're close. If you're not in the same room with your loved one, there's not going to be the same kind of intimacy. That's why in these hard times, in these hard times, it's really important that we're in the room with God. That we have that priority figured out. You come to church and you bring all your D stuff. You come to church with your questions, expecting answers. And you open your heart and you open your ears to what God might say to you during the service. I'm blown away over the years by people who respond to a message and they got out of the message, they go, I didn't even know I was talking about that. But the Holy Spirit sowed it in their hearts in a very special way. Come to the table each week. And remember that when you come to the communion table on a Sunday morning, you're here at the personal invitation of Jesus Christ, the Lord of all creation. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords has extended to you an invitation for you to join him for supper. If the president sent you an invitation, if some important king in the world sent you an invitation, if Queen Elizabeth sent you an invitation to join her for dinner, you'd buy a ticket and you'd be there. And here's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords personally inviting you Sunday after Sunday to join him for supper. And it's his meal. Belongs to him, not to church. Belongs to him. He's carefully prepared it by offering his own body as the bread and his own blood as the juice for the forgiveness of our sins. No need to come here and hide anything from Jesus. He already knows. He already knows. And he's got you covered. Love covers a multitude of sins, the Bible says. He's got you covered. You can come. And in your heart today, you can confess what it is that you want to confess. You come into agreement with God, and he's got you covered. Agreement with God is so much better than repressing or hiding. Listen, in worship, prayer engages your heart. Singing engages your body. Praise engages your soul. Giving engages your will. Teaching engages your mind. But in communion, you are engaged to Jesus. You, the bride of Christ, are engaged to Jesus. And you won't find that any place else in the world. So the greatest things, whether there's four people in church, 4,000 in a church, doesn't matter. None of it matters because where Jesus is, there's intimacy. There's love. There's hope. There's forgiveness. There's life. And you won't find what you find in church anyplace else in the world. Nothing. Nothing compares. Let's pray. Father, we are here because of your great love. You created us and the universe out of love. You created the universe and the world with an eye and a desire for it to be inhabited. You named all the stars. Your love is displayed in so many ways. Now, Father, in this little city of Hermiston, around this table at this moment in time and history, as we take the bread and drink the cup, we're glad that we're here. Glad to share in the body of Christ. and glad to be able to come into agreement with you. Whatever our bruises is, whatever our battles are, whatever our hurts are, whatever's troubling us, depressing us, discouraging us, we bring it all. We bring it right to you right now at the table. And we present it to you, Father, along with our offerings, the offering of our soul, the offering of our allegiance, the offering of our love, the offering of our worship. We bring it all to you, and we worship you, because you are worthy of all praise and all glory and all honor, for you have created and you sustain all things. Through Jesus we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Before I begin, I just want to thank the song team for that Lead Me to the Cross song. There's one of the few songs that really strikes a chord with me, and I just never fails to bring a tear to my eye, because none of us would have been here unless somehow we were led to Christ. So I just want to thank you. Would you repeat with me our affirmation of faith? I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and my personal Lord and Savior. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together, a time to remember your sacrifice and sacrifice of your Son. And Lord, we just pray that we might lead someone else to you just because of the sacrifice you made for us. In Jesus' name, amen. When Jesus was in the room with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup and said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins.